I thought, I've given up booze, that's the hard bit. But that's not the hard bit. You know, the hard bit is 6 months later. It just felt like this wall of demons just sort of were right in my face. And all the things that I had been sort of burying with the booze and drowning in booze all came up almost at once, like just in a kind of a procession, like, here we are.
It's a really jaunty mental image to describe really awful things.
They were delighted to be out.
All this feels strange and untrue, and I won't waste a minute without you.
That was when I closed down, you know. I thought I had to insulate not just my own brain from this, but I have to insulate the outside world from this, because, you know, I felt it was so loud in my head that that people could hear me, you know, on the bus or something like that.
Tell me that you'll open your eyes.
You know, there were times when we were making this, times when I was writing it, you know, when I was alone, when I thought that this was never gonna, I was never gonna get there. And for it to be the day of release, it is.
Without you. Don't give in. Don't you take what's so easy. Give up.
I read a great interview where you said there were parts of your brain that had been pickled that were no longer pickled. What are the parts of your brain that you couldn't access when you're in that state that you can access now?
You know, I quit drinking about 2 years ago, and that helped. The clarity that came with that was the sort of the missing piece. Yeah. I mean, trying to force the album out of a drunken mind.
It's in your blood and it's in your making, so don't hold your tongue, cause it's no longer working.
I think it sort of came with a sort of combined thing of just not being afraid to look into the dark places. All the things I've been hiding from or running from my whole life, I'm not afraid to stare at them anymore. I'm not afraid to share them anymore. I'm not afraid of them anymore. I actually kind of feel like I've made friends with them. And if you can make friends with your monsters, then, you know, you're gonna live a much healthier, happier life. You know, they are part of us all. Our dark places are part of us all. They are formative in a lot of ways. You know, I think that some of our negative experiences inform as much of us as our positive ones. And there's some things in my life that I might never shake off, and that's why I always have to be vigilant of the depression. But if I reel from it, if I'm scared of it, those are the times that I sort of, I've got nowhere else to run. Yeah. I'm only inside my own brain, so yeah. It becomes a labyrinth.
This is another new song that we've never played. This is about my father. My dad has dementia. This song is written about him. It means a lot to me.
It's not an insignificant thing to be public and talk about your father's going through dementia. Take me back to that point where you were writing that song. Was there a catalyst for why you sat down and it started kind of flowing out of you?
Soon you'll not remember anything.
I never told this story, but I was writing another song about my dad. And that every time I would leave home, which was a lot, you know, I would go home and then I would have to go, we'd go on tour, we'd go back to America, whatever. I would say, I love you, Dad, before I left. And he would go, oh, yeah. I know that he loves me, but, you know, you don't hear those words. It's very, you know, it's very Irish kind of thing.
Yeah.
But I was sort of trying to write a song about that, but it just seemed mean. And then I started writing a poem to kind of clear that out. The first stanza, I guess, just came out really easily. Soon you'll not remember anything, but someday neither will I. And it seemed to just connect the both of us, you know.
Soon you'll not remember anything, but then someday neither will I.
Why was it important for you to play it for him in that environment?
Um I wanted him to hear it. I don't know when he might not hear it again. I don't know. During that gig, he turned to my mum and said, when I was talking in between songs, turned to my mum and said, who's that talking there? And my mum said, that's Gary, it's your son. I was like, oh yeah. That was a shift in his illness that hadn't happened up to that point, you know. You know, not only did we play soon for the first time to him, his disease decided that that was the time that it would shift. I can't ride on your coattails again. We've made a video for every song on the album, and what I wanted to do with Soon was I wanted it to be me and my dad watching old home movies of us together. We spent the whole day listening to the song, obviously me singing it, and you know, you're shooting a video, yeah. There's lots of camera crew and people around, and then sometimes he would reach over to me, he was sitting there, I was sitting here, and he would sort of lean over and go, this is great, I'm just singing a song, Dad, you better. we're actually making a video here.
Glad you're having a good time, but I'm going to work.
It was a day that I'll never forget, and at the end of the day, he was emotional. He's not an emotional guy.
Everything
Nathan, why does the band work? Why has it persisted all these years? What do you put it down to?
Stubbornness.
Strong answer, I like it.
I've nowhere else to be. There's so many things with this last 5 years, I think. Just honesty. It's not always easy.
Yeah, we would go whole tours sometimes without actually speaking about anything. Then by the end of the last tour, you know, him and I weren't hardly talking, and that ends up being corrosive because people start to resent each other. Oh, fuck, I can't even talk to these people anymore. Fuck them. Yeah. So you just shut your mouth and you move forward. And it just builds this resentment within the band. And by the end of the last tour,
we had a blowout for sure.
Yeah, we had a very difficult time, and it took a long time after the tour to kind of reconnect with each other. And
how do you start that conversation if you haven't spoken for a while? How do you make that first move?
You just started walking home one night from the studio, and you ended up at my house.
Yeah, that's
which
right.
Was way miles out of your way. Yeah. And you rang my doorbell, and I wasn't expecting to see you there. And the conversation we had that night changed everything. We talked for hours about everything, but all the things that we hadn't said to each other for so long, and we've been extraordinarily close ever since.
If somebody's watching this who is in the sort of dark place that you were in 3-4 years ago, what would you say to them? What would your advice be to that person?
The thing that was hardest for me initially was talking about it at all. These guys didn't know I was going through it. I didn't talk about it for the longest time. From I was a teenager, I was going through this stuff and I never talked about it. I was always too afraid to. The thing that released me from that fear was talking about it. It sounds like the easiest thing in the world, and it can be the most difficult thing in the world. It really can. To actually open your mouth and admit what you're feeling inside is a daunting, daunting thing. Every minute from this minute now. Whatever it is, whatever you're going through, I promise you, whatever it is, I promise to everybody, whatever it is, it's not too hard for your friends to take. You know, or go and see a professional. You know, in fact, speak to your friends about it first and then go and see a professional. You know, it's like open the door with, you know, people that you love and people that you trust. You don't have to live in isolation. I don't feel depressed anymore, although that it's a constant sort of vigil. You have to maintain alert. I'll talk about it, and I'll talk about it openly, and hopefully it leads to other people maybe feeling like they can talk about it openly, or it makes them feel like they're not alone.
Guys, I'm going to go for the double handshake.
You're going for
it. It'll be, yeah.
For all acquaintance be forgot.
The weirdest way to end an interview ever.